that things are a lot more informal than they used to be. Maybe I'll see. My main thing, I don't want everyone to be comfortable, right? So, I think Jim's going to be here.
I think he did an email.
He knows how to open the door. Mm-hmm. All right, so just so you guys know, we are recording this because obviously we have a few planning commissioners here.
Sure. Okay.
So we want to make sure everyone has an opportunity to make an informed decision. We're on everything. It seems like we're on a fast track these days. We're trying to make a recommendation on Thursday so we can get on the next board meeting so we can hit the ground running. Mm-hmm. As I tried to put in a proposal, we have two major projects that are on the horizon. We have water coming in for the first time in the township. Mm-hmm. And then we're working with MDOT to improve the bridge over Thompson Road. And so the water's coming. That's been approved, funding bond. MDOT thing is happening faster than you've ever seen a project happen with MDOT. Because this was started about 6 months ago. We already have funding for it. And so we need to stay ahead of that.
So is the funding from all the federal grants there?
Yeah.
When is the water anticipated to?
All right, so that's what we were just talking about. So county's still telling us they're going to start this year. Regardless, it's going to be done. The phase one will be done next year. It's probably next fall. Phase two is supposed to start next year. It'll be done the following year. And so phase one brings it down Fenton Road, across Thompson, all the way up to Jennings. So it's going to go across the highway. Phase two brings down Jennings, across Larry, up to Torrey. And phase two is really the important part in how we got our funding for it, because it hooks all the schools up together. We have arsenic in our water, and this, everyone has to mediate it somehow. And this allows the schools to use municipal water. So do you guys want to start your presentation here? And then we'll probably have some more discussion and some questions.
Sure. I'm Liz. I'm the one communicating with you, and this is Kyle.
Hello.
And thank you for taking a special meeting today for us. We probably have to commute twice, so thank you for doing that. We are going to give a brief presentation overview, and then I'm happy to answer any questions.
That's the assessment. The door has a lot of lock on it. So if you're clicking, that's you're locking or unlocking that. So good reading.
Got it. Okay. So you obviously know Beckett and Rader. We did your 2018 plan. And there's a few highlights about what we have to offer. We've been in operation for over 5 years based in Michigan. We now have offices in main one still in Ann Arbor, but we have a Rapids office in Oxby and Traverse City, and still do some work in Ohio. So still prevalent in the area. We are a smaller planning team, so we work really closely with clients, like almost that 5 years ago. And we are our commitment is we really focus on placemaking and working together, collaborating with clients directly. And then, as you saw in the 2018 plan, we really focus on that implementation section, making sure that we have achievable goals and objectives. Give a brief introduction to our team. I'm Liz, obviously. I've been working at Beck and Rader for about 4 years now. Prior to that, prior to going back to getting a master's in planning, I worked for several years in Indiana for a company office. So very familiar and have a lot of experience with rural, more rural communities. Many of the issues there.
I'm Kyle Wilkes. I'm relatively new to Beckett Rader, but I have over 15 years of experience in planning, primarily in Southeast Michigan or Southeast Michigan as well as in Florida. And I'm recently back from Simple Florida and back home. I'm a Michigan native and looking forward to working back in Southeast Michigan and across the state.
And then other team members, we have John Ecolangeli, who we've likely worked with before. But he's been with Beckett Rader. He's one of our principals. He's been with us for over 30 years, so lots of experience in helping you help oversee the project. And then Mitchell on the bottom left there, she is a planner as well. We'll be helping with research and graphics. She was previously an architect. And then Rowan is on the right there, is our GIS specialist. So that's all of our spatial analysis and sort of data analysis. So that would be the team. So our vision would be to take the 2018 plan and update content where necessary with demographics and land use. And then the big part of this project would be economic development and what is the vision for that Thompson Bay road area. So taking that community input and developing the vision for township. Then something we've started doing recently is doing, realistically, people aren't reading a long communication. So obviously the information is very important, but not everybody's gonna read it. So what we've been doing recently, and I think it's probably because my background is in graphic design, is creating more of like a pull-out document as well, so that it's really helpful to give, especially to developers or residents who are interested. So it's just a couple pages and just highlights of what the township is trying to do, what the goals are, so that it's something you can give and you're not asking them to read hundreds of pages. So that's been really useful. In other communities that we've worked in. So that's what this sort of magazine style idea. So I'm going to go through a couple of the scope highlights and just to go over what we submitted. So like I said, the community engagement portion of the project is going to be big. We did do a survey in 2018. And so one thing that we could do since we did that one is have some similar questions and then compare results. We have things that changed since 2018. But we also have some different questions possibly specific to that Thompson Bay area. And then this redevelopment workshop that we're proposing, try to explain it, sometimes a little bit difficult to explain, but you'll see the top images have a workshop with colored blocks. We've done this in a couple of communities and it's been really successful. This particular example is in East Jordan, Michigan, which is up north. It's sort of like a charrette almost. People would have sort of the Thompson Road area on a map, and then they have these blocks. The blocks represent different types of land uses. So, for example, the yellow blocks would be single family residential, and then other block blue typically uses more of a civic use. Purple is mixed use. So people can use the blocks and sort of develop what they want to see there. It's usually pretty fun, it's interactive. We found that if people have something to do, they enjoy it more and there's more participation. So in this particular example, the top images were the East Jordan workshop. And we took the preferences from that workshop and developed the bottom image. Which is a conceptual image of what people wanted to see. And then just a few months ago, the city of East Jordan took this concept image and released just an RFQ to developers to develop that site in that way. So that's sort of how the ensemble of how the vision exercise should turn into. Any questions about that process?
So maybe not questions, more of comments. You know, we just went through a whirlwind update about Thompson Road Corridor. Mm-hmm. And you know, we did resource mapping as part of the you know, public participation. We had three, four, five different sessions, you know, where we presented resource mapping, we had big idea boards, information about water lines, and presented options for the road overpass and things like that. And obviously, right, we had participation at the beginning and then it dwindled off. Obviously, you know, I think with all the economic development opportunities going on, and revisiting the Thompson Road corridor is important. But at the same time, I think that there's board members that are concerned that we're only focusing on the corridor, and that we need to also protect and identify the key aspects of the rest of the township and include that in the planning process.
I 100% agree. I think we could use the same idea and do the Thompson Road area, but also pick other areas and then, yeah, do the same sort of.
For me, I think a very important aspect of what of this new plan is we have to identify our urban service boundary, because we don't want water everywhere. We don't want sewer everywhere, and it's very easy for the creep to happen. And so we need to have some solid guidelines, like, all right, you know, if you're in the Northwest, that's you're not getting water.
Yeah. And it's not financial feasible either. Okay. Yeah, I think we could definitely sort of take this idea and expand it to other things. Okay. Then in terms of the area or the different sections of the plan, we're proposed to the mission planning enabling it has different sections of the master plan. So we keep those background and regional trends, we update current regional trends, and then we often like to compare to neighboring communities just to see where you stand in relation to neighbors. We do the same with demographics. We now have 2020 census data and looked, looks like we have 2021 community survey data. So that should all be pretty up to date. So we'll update everything there. And then, you know, like I was talking about taking more of a graphic approach, it makes it more readable, kind of doing more public profiles throughout the plan. That's just highlights graphs and key points or key trends that happen. So that's just an example from a different plan on how we did that. And then land use, we just update and get your most up-to-date assessment. I think just going to use those and update those.
Yeah, so I think, you know, Michael, you brought up about sort of that creep. And it's very important, I think, to look at that in this section as well, because in the last community survey in 2018 and then also in 2006, you know, a lot of folks in Fenton said, well, one of the major reasons the draws were, you know, quality of life issues, the schools, the low crime, and then, of course, your recreational amenities, as well as housing. And what I found interesting about housing was that folks from 2006, 2018 were happier with the type and the style of housing that they found in the township. But as you noted, once water goes in, they probably want that type of housing, but not everywhere, right? And so I think key to this plan are these elements, because we can look at those trends. Obviously, look at your existing natural features and recreational amenities, combined with the housing trends and those potential changes, as well as the pressure that's going to come from the new infrastructure, and say, okay, we know how the township may change. How do we change it that protects Fenton's quality of life, a sense of community, and protects that sort of rural heritage that you have. And creates maybe you know, neighborhoods within the township where growth is directed rather than just sprawled, to protect those areas as well as the natural features. So we're going to look first at the housing and say, what are the trends, you know, as nationwide and regionally, the population ages, what are some of the potential demand or needs, or maybe it stays the same, but we're going to look at that, those trends, and then as well, how do we accommodate those feasibly as and protect those natural features. And as you can see here, we're going to do it graphically because pictures and visuals tell the story. And that's kind of along the lines of this pullout and this magazine style that we do, make it quick and easy for anybody to pick up and say, here's where Fenton is, here's where it's going. And speaking of where it's going, of course, transportation is also key. One of the things that's great is that folks love the ability to enjoy the Inland Lakes. They love the recreation facilities that are there. But they also said last time that they wanted more hiking trails, more bike bicycle amenities as well. And so not just looking at how do you go from place to place at roadway classifications and traffic, but also look at ways in which the township can feasibly and cost effectively, you know, leverage resources, whether through the private sector or otherwise, to build an actionable plan for, you know, non-motorized transportation that really connects folks both in and outside of the township to the recreational amenities in the area. And so this section will allow us to do that, but also sort of start to guide that growth in a way that protects the natural environment as well.
And then the last couple sections, like I said, economic development will probably be a big part of this plan. They're talking a little bit about the current activity in the township and in the area. But then, like you said, prioritizing a couple of different sites to really want this to go. We recently acquired a new software system called InPlan. It's a way to analyze, basically a way to analyze redevelopment opportunities. We've done it a couple of places, and Rowan, our GIS person, is the main person doing it.
Young
a wizard with me. Yes. That is also a better way. But what it does essentially is you can quantify based on what we can put in. All right, we want to put in a 5,000 square foot building for retail. And then based on existing economic conditions in the area, I can give an estimate of what that development would produce. So there are all sorts of analyses we can do with that. That's pretty nice. And we can do many different scenarios and test out a bunch of things just to see what different types of development we can do in this particular area. And then finally, the future land use submission zoning neighborhood act requires a future land use map and zoning plans, so we've updated those for the township. Biggest changes would probably be in those. Or those focused redevelopment areas. And then the action plan, so an example action plan on the screen, but we have the current blueprint that has also the action plan that we did. So we probably start with what your current action plan is, go through probably the planning commission, see what has been accomplished, what still needs work, use that as a base, and then obviously make some changes, but we always like to have a direct action item, say who the responsible party is, who your partners are, and those time frames so that things are measurable. Then just in summary, why BRI? We have obviously worked with us in the past. We have a pretty thorough understanding of the township and we have all of the data and research that we did the last time that we could start with. Like I said, we're a Michigan-based firm. We have a lot of experience with Michigan. Both Kyle and I are Michigan leaders and love Southeast Michigan, so that's a plus. We've won more master plan awards than any firm in the state. Something I think is really good with our planning team is we have a pretty wide array of professional backgrounds. So we're all planners now, but before, I was in graphic design, the architect, our GIS, Kristen, was, his background is in environmental plan or environmental science. Kyle's background is in public administration, in economics. So a wide range of experience. Another thing that some other firms don't necessarily have is we do spatial analysis for everything and we value that. So our GIS is a pretty strong aspect. And then also because of our graphic backgrounds, we do metamath for telling the story visually.
Any
questions?
Sure. Do you guys have questions? So
the team, just that would be the team working on here. So you just presented that.
The team, the main people working, sorry, this is the team, but the main people working on the plan would be these five. A lot of times, we also, our BRI has planning, landscape architecture, and engineering. So on many projects, we'll often collaborate amongst the three fields. So for example, if you needed landscaping recommendations, you would tap into our landscape architects for specific ideas. You came up with sort of a concept of the Thompson Road area. We use our LAs to create those that sort of thing. But in terms of actually drafting the plan, doing the community engagement, it would mostly be useful. And Kyle and I would do the primary.
So several times you mentioned the fact that you did do the previous plan, but I guess I would hate to see that what you're looking at is a continuation of that plan, that you're going to do an overlook. I mean, things have changed a lot since 18, and I just would like to make sure that you're looking at it basically kind of with new eyes, new ways, and not just saying, hey, we kind of said we're going to do this. We kind of come up with this conclusion last time, and that was very great.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think the value of us having done the previous plan is we can use that sort of as a base just in terms of data. But yeah, obviously a lot has changed in 5 years, plus we have the COVID pandemic that has drastically changed everything.
And that was one of my questions, right? I mean, the world is a totally different place than it was back.
Exactly. Yeah.
So,
how do you see COVID affecting your master plans? I mean, the way we utilize land is different than it was, 36 months ago.
Yeah, I mean, generally speaking, office uses existent anymore, and we're still not really working in office. And then office and retail are the big. So, it's changed.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I think one of the important things for you all too is that's both a blessing and a curse. Whereas if you once may have to, let's say, commute down to the Rensselaer, but you love living up here because of the quality of life. But I know that GM is a bad example because I know they're forcing people back in the office now, but which is good for downtown Detroit, I guess. But why wouldn't you? If you could live at a place and enjoy and be close to what you enjoy every day, why not? But that brings with it all new issues that you all might have to deal with, because now you have pressure and growth. And I think it really lends itself to not just a refresh of the look that we're proposing in terms of how it's presented, but also what is presented. And that means that we need to look through different lenses this time too, and do it in a way that's contextual to the community, to the region, and clearly to the township, because everything that we knew 5, 10, 15 was gone. So
could you like give an example of a recent master plan that you worked on where, you know, that new ideas have come out because of how COVID, mm-hmm. you know, happened?
We're currently working in, first I did like this one, we're currently working in Novi, and did a housing market analysis. Part of it, the plan is, you know, it's about halfway through right now, but that section of the plan talks about how COVID has completely changed the housing market. Because one, people are working from home, one, people are wanting bigger spaces, places with office space, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But in terms of, you know, commercial uses for the same, because of COVID, you know, people are ordering online, they're not going to places to buy. Right. Even groceries, so that it's just completely changed the entire.
So that's a good point, right? You bring up, you know, Amazon has invaded my house, mm-hmm. right? I have Alexa everywhere. Where we have deliveries basically, you know, 3 times a week.
Did you know?
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Are you addressing that in your master plans, and, you know, mm-hmm. identifying that, you know, the residential uses, you know, maybe the streets need to be designed to take into consideration, mm-hmm. you know, deliveries that would, you know, typically, you know, in the past been only a commercial use.
Yes, we're definitely talking about that, and not in just master plan, but limiting what size of delivery trucks. This is obviously a master plan, but right. It's definitely coming up a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And even, and not just deliveries, but in terms of land use, and distribution sites are also big.
Right.
Which might come up.
Sure. So Fenton Township is kind of like a township in, potentially a township in transition,
mm-hmm.
right? Been a bedroom vacation community forever. And now if development happens like, you know, our supervisor thinks it's going to,
mm-hmm.
that could bring significant changes. Have you worked in a community that's sort of been that transition from, you know, going from your bedroom community to more of a destination community?
Yes. A couple of years ago, we worked in Grand Blanc a little different, but they have had certain nodes that they were focusing on developing, especially
Southwark Township. Yes. Forget notes that were the north part of township.
Yes. So, the north area and in the south area.
Yeah.
And so a similar idea, there's always, you know, want development, obviously, but want to support for residents. So yes. Well, regardless of the place, there's always going to be tension,
mm-hmm.
development. And, you know, not to, for development, they don't want development to encroach there.
So what challenges have you seen with lake communities that you think should be addressed in the master plan? So what challenges have you seen in lake communities that should probably be addressed in the master plan? Like, you know, you wouldn't necessarily have, you know, those issues in other communities, and they'd be handled differently.
Sure. Well, obviously water quality number one, and, you know, the preservation of the access and open space on those lakes. You know, there's going to be a ton of people who probably already live there, and more people who are going to want to live there. You know, finite amount of space, then there's also the ability to enjoy that for whether you live there or not. And, you know, one of the things that I think is great about the township is the ability to do just that, you know. But obviously there's a need based, well, at least there was before the last master plan, folks saying, you know, we want to be able to get around the township more and enjoy the natural amenities like the lakes, and do so, you know, biking, walking, things too. I worked on a, not here in Michigan, but I worked in a, on a project on a master plan down in Central Florida. And it was a city, incorporated city near Disney, and it was a bedroom community for many, many years. And now, you know, it's the ninth fastest growing city in the country, and it has gone from 14,000 to almost 60 on a very large inland lake. And that lake has become the focal point, you know, and all the smaller inland lakes too. And with that became, how do we protect the lakefront, use the lakefront to leverage, use lakes to leverage our economic development, either through ecotourism or having folks come in for recreational opportunities, but also still maintain the environmental quality in the area as well. And those have been huge. I think, especially here in Michigan, there's so many different lakes, and the township does as well. I think what, 17, 18? And it's
a
like,
lot.
Yeah, a lot. So it's like, you know, those are going to be a big draw. But you said it's a potential to be at a tipping point. And how do you anticipate and manage that growth, but guide it in a way that protects the very thing that people came here to enjoy. But that is, I mean, that's always going to be a battle, but one that you just got to keep going, right?
So one of the big issues that I'm dealing with that hasn't gone to the Planning Commission yet, but we're going to have to talk about it, is short-term rentals.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and during this master plan process, we need to get public opinion on it, because especially since COVID, more, I mean, before COVID, we did not have complaints about Airbnbs. Right? We didn't. And now it seems like every week we're getting new complaints. And I know states looking to take away our control. And so that's sort of why it's been on the back burner on our end. We don't want to go through the process of updating something just to have it, you know, shot down as soon as it gets approved. But I think we need to include, you know, get the public opinion on that as part of this process.
Yeah, it's especially a really big issue more in up north communities, the Travis City. But yes, we in several master plans have asked about opinions about short-term rentals, and then can give you recommendations for best practices and getting your support. Obviously, depending on what the state legislature does.
Yeah, so, you know, I view there being an opportunity to use that hook of discussing short-term rentals as actually getting people to show up to meetings to participate.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, looking at the public participation that you guys have laid out for us, survey, workshop, and that's really the extent of the public participation, or?
That's what we've proposed, but we can, if there are other things that, if the scope isn't set in stone, so we can certainly modify based on what you want.
Conceptually, it almost seems like we would use the hook of short-term rentals, and we're debating the mailing out notices that everyone was on the lake,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
So
often done almost like a focus group, and I assume you have homeowners associations around the lakes,
mm-hmm.
You can see those as targets, and it's a hot topic, so
right.
I think that would
be really helpful with the Michigan realtors in the state too.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The B&Bs on
it? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's been, I just had a meeting about it today.
Well, that's why you're on the board now. To help give us some direction on that type of stuff.
So yeah, we could do something, you know, use short-term rentals as the hook.
Right.
Potentially, but then also
Right. Yeah. So I guess to get back to what my thought process was, you know, meeting one for the general public is use short-term rentals, get people in the door. That helps narrow down some specific questions that we could do in a second meeting, you know, with the public. Where now, all right, you're involved now, right? You have interests. Mm-hmm. These are the issues we need to look at besides the interests that you have.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So just thinking aloud, if where you could use, you know, do a couple of different meetings and have different focus areas also talk about. Mm-hmm. But yeah, depending on what firm you decide to go with, if you go with Beckett and Rader, you can obviously modify the description.
Okay. I'm gonna be one of those people a lot late.
Yeah, look, I mean, that's Margaret Drive is one of the ones I get calls all the time. So.
Well, you talk to anybody, they say, oh, it's too busy.
Yeah.
I don't live on the lake and I agree.
Yeah, I mean, do you get a lot of like code enforcement issues or?
Yeah, so.
Even growing over the years?
So, code enforcement issues that we get every day. Now it's Airbnb, checking them out, seeing so, you know, what's going on. People having other people's boats at their property, you know?
Yeah.
You know, we have one part-time, you know, one's not part-time, it's 4 days a week, but, you know, we can't literally monitor everything, so we work on a complaint basis, you know, making sure people aren't turning, you know, docks into marinas and things like that. Well, yeah. So expect, you know, part of our process, you know, for docks is that, you know, the approval for the dock in itself is from Eagle. And then, you know, we regulate, you know, who can use it. But we have a mobile home park on the lake, and you know, all right, they have 30 units, so 30 docks, right? I mean, okay, but now we all know, you know, those aren't all going to be used by, you know, the residents, and now it's an enforcement issue for us. So we get those, you know, the standard complaints, you know, weeds, fences, you know, we spend most of our time being parents, you know, and you know, it's the same issues over and over again.
Maybe we do, since our community is growing, maybe we do need to hire somebody though that's dedicated for that to protect the community in those things.
Yeah, look, if that's a recommendation that comes out of this, then that, you know, I don't think we need to limit ourselves to any recommendation. You know, like I said, we're in a community transition. And if we identify things, we can get ahead of it. You know, then that'd be great.
And there in your plan for justification for funding.
Well, exactly too. And I was going to say one of the things that we like to do is, you know, recognize the need for vision, but the utter importance for practicality and for adoptability and feasibility. You know, in an action plan, you know, that might be an item that may not be as exciting as a, you know, a 3D representation, but is utterly necessary to protect quality of life and tax base, or at least perceived tax base, right? So, you know, those type of things, you know, from an action point, crucial because, you know, folks, I mean, we probably understand that, you know, one little ordinance related to code enforcement could be a huge dip or lack thereof, right, mm-hmm. could be a huge nightmare. So,
right.
You know, one of the things that we like to do, and one of the things that Implant will give us the opportunity to do, is look at where we can find that revenue to help support things like that too, you know, potentially. So, that's key.
Yeah, look, another thing that we are doing is that we are in the process of hiring grant writers for the township.
Okay.
Right, so anything that we do with the master plan is gonna help inform their applications, and you know, a lot of the direction that we do are is going to be focused towards some sort of, you know, grant opportunity, whether it's pathways and sidewalks, you know, a boat for code enforcement, you know, you know, not just trying to improve Thompson Road, but identifying, you know, other aspects in the township where we can make improvements. You know, right now, water is only going along, you know, believe they're out there, right? Thompson, you know, you've been around. But we have so many homes that are small lots along the lakes, and it's stopping like right before it gets there. And so being able to provide water to all the lake homes is a huge future goal, you know, that we have internally. It's something that we need to address in the plan.
Is that potable, or is that also waste? Are they accepted?
Well, we have sewer.
Oh, sewer. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how that happened, how we got sewer and not water, but it's probably money.
Yeah, that was.
Yes.
This implant program you talked about, so the information, so you must have to update that information based on this community, you know, because what you know.
Yeah, for the like base information, it pulls data from census, all sorts of different sources.
Right.
And then, yeah, we can do that from other analyses with different proposals. And then the township would obviously get all of those outputs and all of that data.
Because a program like that's only gives the information you put into it. Right? Mm-hmm. So. But the information is more locally.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's all based on Penn Township's data or regional data.
Right.
So one of the questions I have about future land use maps. In the last one you guys did, right, it was category for schools. Mm-hmm. If a school wants to redevelop their property, mm-hmm. how do you view that? Future land use plan that we advise it as a school?
Well, future land use map, it's not like zoning, it's not legally binding, it's a guideline.
Yeah.
There's nothing in the planning or zoning guidelines that requires it to be what you said it is. I typically talk to communities who can, if there's something. But that's ultimately why you're revisiting the master plan for 5 years. This needs to change.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, if the school is wanting to redevelop their neighboring property that is in the building of the school, and if it makes sense, general support, if they're having to do the proposed changes to the school property and an amendment to the future land use plan.
So, would another option be to just not include a school? Classification.
You could, make it pop. I would recommend making it a more general, like civic, for example, category. So for this time around.
You guys have any other questions? All right.
May I ask?
Sure.
Just in general, how involved is the planning commission in projects and decision making?
Very. But I used to be a consultant for a couple of years, and I've told people that if the planning commission and zoning boards that I dealt with were like Penn Township, I'd still be a consultant. Right? I mean, everyone visits sites, they review packets before they come to the meeting. You don't see anyone's opening the envelope as they sit down. You know, like it's been nice, right? Review of site plan. Before I got here, planning commission did everything. Right? They had a consultant, a zoning administrator from Roe as a consultant. But they really did the site plan reviews themselves, right? They did the special use reviews themselves. Now I'm able to provide them, additional support and background and that stuff, but they're very involved. You guys are very involved.
That's great. I always ask.
And we have a lot of professionals on there, right? Phil is an engineer.
Architect.
I'm sorry. Right. we have real estate agents. We have attorneys, land use attorneys. We have inspectors. It's
not always.
No, it's not. It is not. So
Okay, I guess my last question, you've sort of already answered, but you're putting this before the planning commission this week,
yep,
which is Thursday. And then when do you expect to sort of let the final decisions?
Yeah, so it has to go in front of the board. Board meets the 18th, right? So it's going to be in front of the board on the 18th. Right, but obviously on the Friday, you know, we'll let you know what the recommendation from the planning commission is. But yeah, like I said, we're not wasting time.
Yeah, and it's so 2018, it'll be up for, you know, 5-year review next year. Is there a push for that reason, or mostly just because of all the?
Because everything's changed. nothing's the same.
Yeah. And that's because we had a community that was working with a couple months ago that they wanted their master plan done by April 1st. And they thought that because that was when their former plan had been adopted, they had to do that. Maybe one of these things is
yeah, no, we're doing this a little bit early because we recognize that the old one's not valid anymore.
Great. All right, for my cards. So if you have any other further questions, but you have my email
address,
so yeah, anything else comes up. And thank you again for making a special meeting.